that's usually a good sign. So, welcome to our second Feeling Funny comedy night. I'm not sure if you all know why we're here, but I'm going to give you a little bit of background just before we start with the evening's proceedings. I'm Helen Holden and I'm the project coordinator for the Feeling Funny project at the Comedy Trust. You'd be pleased to know I'm the least funny person that you're going to see tonight. So it's only going to get better from here on in. But it is. But yeah, a few months ago we were fortunate enough to get a grant through Liverpool Clinical Commissioning Group. It's part of their Healthy Liverpool Community Grants Programme. We were fortunate to get 3 years worth of funding to put on 3 comedy courses specifically aimed at men. And this is the second of the comedy course, or the second evening of our finale event. And the course has been an introductory 6-week course to stand-up comedy, but it's been quite a unique course. It's not just an average stand-up comedy course. It's about using comedy as a way to help men really break down that taboo of mental health issues, not being able to talk about them more openly. So by using comedy and humour to do so, we're finding that that's a really good way to get them talking. Because as we know, men aren't very good at opening up about their feelings. They're not very good about going to the doctors to talk about physical health problems, never mind mental health problems. So this is just a slightly different way of doing it. And hopefully through the process, it's obviously a very small part of a much bigger picture. And the idea being about using non-medical approaches to try and help people's well-being and to make people feel better. So throughout the course, the participants have been learning the techniques of how to do stand-up comedy, obviously forging relationships with other people on the course, which the social side of it is really important as well. So they're learning new skills, increasing their confidence, getting to meet other people and just allowing them to have the opportunity to talk about mental illness, which even for any of us can be a tricky thing. 1 in 4 people in any given year will experience a mental health problem. So it's really important that we carry on this kind of work and try to help people's mental well-being. Just a little plug for any other men who haven't already been on one of our Feeling Funny courses, that we've got our next course coming up at the end of October. So if anyone is got a burning desire to do some stand-up, then come and see me at the end of in the break. It sounds like a teacher now. Come and see me in the break and I'll tell you more about it. So, but it's just very briefly to say, it's been an absolute pleasure project managing something like this, because it's great to see how people progress. They truly have all done an amazing job, and it's no mean feat to get up here and do stand-up comedy. I'm bad enough just getting up here to tell you what it's all about, so I'm sure you'll appreciate what bravery and guts it takes to get on stage and make you all laugh, and I'm sure you'll be a great audience in supporting everyone. So without further ado, just to wish everyone, well, I said good luck before, but apparently that's bad on the break a leg. And yeah, have a great night. Thanks all for coming.
Thank you.
Avery.
Thank you very much. Hello. Hello. I forgot to introduce me there at the end, which is a little bit awkward. But, and also, she did all my material, so I've got none left. But it's good to see you all, folks. Thanks for coming. Have you seen live comedy before?
Yeah.
About 6, yeah. Brilliant. Good. Kimichi, this is the first time you've ever seen live comedy. Someone put his hand up there, not really understanding the question, but that's okay, that's alright. Welcome to the show. Give me a cheer if you didn't understand the first 2 questions. Pretty much everyone, we're all on the same page now, ladies and gentlemen, it's all good. It's good to see some familiar faces at the front as well, even though we did a course together, still not making eye contact in case I pick on you. Don't worry, fellas, you know where I live, so I'm not going to take the piss tonight. How are you? You all good? All good? Good stuff, you've learned some good heckles, I'm sure, since, yeah? So, you bet. Oh, I didn't see you there, Steve. How are you doing? Yeah, good. You stuck in like a ninja there. That's brilliant. It's all good. Who came to see the last course? had two people, it was a tough night. This is much bigger than I know. It was great, really good. So, yeah, it's good. We've got lots of new people as well who've not been informed. Thanks for coming. But a guy there with his arms folded, like, this is going to be shit. This is going to be terrible. It's all going to be good. All I need to do for you to do, folks, is a little audience, little warm-up game. I'm going to ask everyone to do this just to get us all on the same page. Can everyone just put your arms in the air, please? Both arms in the air. That's it. Everyone put your drinks down if you need to put your arms in the air. Wiggle your fingers a little bit. That's nice. Then just move them to the side. And then it's the lap of the person next to you. Just, there we go. You can stand up, fellas. There we go. Everyone's warm up. So good. This is nice. So obviously we've got a lot of scouts in, I'm sure. Good to see you from Liverpool. Okay. Anyone not from Liverpool? Decent mix, okay. So, who's from further afield then? Who's not from Liverpool? Sound very angry as well, that's good. Where are you from? Is it?
Runcorn,
Scotland. Okay, there's been an earthquake, ladies and gentlemen. Runcorn is now in Scotland. And frankly, we can have it. Joking. Who said Runcorn? Oh, that's Craig, mix from the Comedy Trust, who I know quite well. He lives in Runcorn, he lives under the bridge, ladies and gentlemen. He's a shop. Married to his mum, he's also his dad and his sister, so it's just a stereotype running for. But you said Scotland?
Hey!
Whereabouts in Scotland?
Lindsay, but I don't live there.
Yeah, I've lost the accent a little bit there. Is that North Dundee? It doesn't sound like Central Dundee to me. Where's the accent? Where have you lived? You live in Wavertree. Oh, so you got a little twang. How long have you been in Wavertree?
Too long.
Too long, okay. Spreading the seeds of happiness across Liverpool, ladies and gentlemen. I've been in this city too long. I've got your bloody accent now. But that's good. What brought you to Liverpool, my love?
My husband.
Your husband in the boot of his car. The beautiful romantic meeting. Get in there, boots. Okay, how long have you been married?
35 years.
35 years? That's I can feel pain in your voice there though when you said that. Is he a romantic? Is he with you tonight, your husband?
He's here.
Keep him very quiet. So, did you pop the question to her 35 years ago, sir? By text, I'll imagine, by text. Such things 35 years ago. How did you propose, my friend? Back to you in the front. How are you doing, Alice? Yeah. That's good. Did he? Sorry? Was it rude? I didn't hear it. Was it rude? She was pregnant. Okay. That's fair enough. I'm not going to judge. But, so what was it like? Ah, you opened the door. For might as well. You know what I mean? I bought a ring. Here's a bag of nappies. Let's do it. Well, it's good that you're here. It's good that you're here. Thanks for coming all the way from. Well, I was going to say Dundee, Wavertree. Thanks for going all the way from Wavertree, all those 6 miles to see us. Anyone else from further afield? Anyone else? Someone else cheated? Who else is from outside Liverpool? Everyone's going to get quiet now. I'm not talking to you. It's nice, it's nice. The funniest thing I've ever seen at a gig was in Liverpool, because it was a show and I had, I think it was 9 or 10 Germans on the front row. And I said to them, what are you doing here? Like, not in a UK kind of way. I mean, like, no. And then, what brings you to our fair city? And this German, who's like the head of the group, he put his hand up and he was really polite. He said, they were here to learn the language. Which I thought was an interesting choice, wasn't it? Because I love Liverpool, but it is an interesting accent that we've got. I'm not sure it's the best way to learn the Queen's English, is it? What are you going to learn when you go back to Berlin? Like, what did you learn, Klaus? Oh, ich bin ein Norbert. You live in Beth, you know what I mean? It's like, And there's a funny mentality in Liverpool, because I said, ladies and gentlemen, the Germans are in, and everyone was deaf friendly, it was beautiful, everyone clapped and cheered, welcome to our city, it was gorgeous. And I'm like, here's on the back of me next to them. And then I said, can anyone else tell me if they're from out of town? And the girl at the back put her hand up, and I said, where are you from? She said, Manchester, someone got glassed, right? That's how we operate in Liverpool. If we've had a war with you, we'll be friends after that, but if you're in the end of the moment, well, you're a knobhead, right? That's how we operate. And this is where I got myself into trouble, and you seem like a lovely audience, and it's going to be great tonight, by the way. This is where I got myself into trouble, because I said what I shouldn't have said. I asked the question to the audience. It was a Friday night, and I said to the Germans, how long are you here for? And they said, oh, we're here till Monday. And I said, have you got any plans? They went, no, we haven't got any plans. I said, oh, right, can anyone recommend anything we can do for the rest of the weekend? And this angry scouser stood up and went, yeah, tell them to fix the friggin' bombed out church. friendliest city in the world, friendliest taxi drivers in the world. That was in the Echo 2 months ago, wasn't it? Friendliest taxi drivers in the world. Yeah, that's right, isn't it? Yeah. Friendliest taxi drivers, where are we, Lime Street, where are you going? The Beatles Museum, I'll take you to see the group by a friggin' Homescape. Come on, let's go. Keep your camera there then. So listen, mate, this is a great audience. You seem up for a good night comedy. You all up for this night?
Yeah.
Because I don't want to put too much pressure on you. You've got to play a big role tonight, because you're going to be there. You're going to provide the claps, the laughs, the applause. So don't mess this up, okay? Let's keep this on an even keel. It's going to be great. We've got 10 performers. Give me a woo.
Woo!
We've got one interval. Give me a wee. That's what interval's for, ladies and gentlemen. Have a little wee. Leave your seats. Don't be a scumbag. The bar's shut while the acts are on, and also we ask you, there's a couple of rules of the night, like work as well as possible. Please don't chat while the acts are on, please don't heckle when the acts are on, even if they're doing material about you. Wait till you get them out and then batter them, do it that way. Please don't chat while the acts are on, take your mobile phones off if you've got a phone and you can't get a reception down here. You're obviously from the future, so that rule's run gone out. But put it on silent if you could, that'd be fantastic. When Jack comes on stage, all I need from you folks is like the biggest round of applause we can possibly muster all together. Clapping, cheering, lots of enthusiasm, and keep that going until they get to the middle and they're about to start, because nothing kills the buzz more than the applause stopping when they're about there. This like massive live egg, and then it just goes, they're just like, right, so we don't want lots of confusion, lots of noise, so we'll have a little practice one. I'm going to count to three, and I'd like everyone in the room to clap their hands as hard as possible, okay? 1, 2, 3, clap in your hands. We'll do that again, and this time we're going to sprinkle some cheering in as well, ladies and gentlemen. 1, 2, 3, everybody clap and cheer. Final one, clapping, cheering, American style whoops as well. 1, 2, 3. Awesome. He clearly didn't want to do it. He went, I'm going to do it anyway. Even though I'm going to do it in a kind of macho way. That's cooler than any man. Well done, thank you. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, tonight's the culmination of the Feeling Funny course, the current one that we're doing. It's going to be fantastic. Don't take photos of me, I'm signing on. It's going to be great. They've been doing a 6-week course with us. They're going to come on stage tonight. This is all their own material. They're all been working on themselves. I'm very excited to welcome on our first act. Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready for your first act?
Yeah!
Okay, come on, let's cheer it together. Come on, let's get that.
Very short stage, but they're so like kind of irritating. They're like something out. And only like overnight, you can have one and 100 the next day. So I mean, like, so, you know, I'll be bankrupt if I was paying bedroom tax on a little bastard. So, you know, this is one of those things. And the other thing as well is, what gets me as well, have you ever had that where you've got your recyclable bin? Right, and when you get to your recyclable bin, somebody's put like something, you know, one of the paper scoop bags in. Now, that is not very recyclable, ladies and gentlemen, you know what I mean? And if it was recyclable, I mean, like something, you know, can you imagine, like something, you know, number two doors down, and kind of saying, oh, you smell a bit wicked this morning, ooh, damn on. You know, like that kind of thing going on. And also, I like to relax, if you believe it or not, ladies and gentlemen. I do like to chill. Now, there was like a time where you had like sort of, you know, colouring books for children. But now, we have things like stress colouring books where, you know, it's kind of chill people out. Well, you know, I tried this, I bought myself a burlesque colouring book. Try and cross my back consoles. And then before you know it, I kind of have to keep it to myself. So, you know. Yeah, so we were on with that one. And also, what gets me is the alpha male. What is it with these action heroes that don't aim? You know, it's so annoying. It's like the actual, like, Arthur's got the back. You know, it's like that. Who's just lost his TV, had to get a job, and I mean, like, so, you know, before you know it, he's kind of like, so, you know, he's been shot down by somebody who can't bloody aim, you know. And I mean, like, so, you know, that's just the way to go. Well, they're not much of an hero now. But one of the things I like to cover is, I'm an 80s kid, and, like, so I was brought up with, like, sort of linos and kind of, like, sort of, you know, radio tapes and things like that. And I like to the hip hop era. So I'd like to just do a little rendition of that for you now. And it starts off with this. When I say ho, you say ho! Okay. Right, okay, so here we go. Bum, bum, bum. Bum, 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 bum. I said, hip hop, stand up, I'd like to sing the song. Do a little dance from a handstand event, and I felt there was something wrong. So I rang the GP, I wondered if he'd see me. He said that that was fine. He set the date, I had to wait till I aged in 5 years' time. I rang the desk, I had to pretend I'm cured before I'm seen. She said, trust me, Joe, I know your problem, you won't fix that with cream. So I took the light in the dark, and he took a look, and he said, you wild, make love. He said, you've got five dicks, and I tell you this, you're in the pen to fit like a glove. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Let's all go. Let's all turn up. That was brilliant. Do you know what? Going on first in any comedy show, the hardest spot of all. Can we have another round of applause?
Fantastic. I signed up for that straight away. The thing was, at the time I got the email, I thought, I was feeling a bit happy actually. I thought, well, I'm not depressed enough. Maybe I should go off my meds for a couple of weeks. So I'm a bit more depressed. You're not supposed to go off your meds straight away because you get these side effects and one of them is harming other people. So, watch out the front row, actually. No, I'm all right. I didn't stop taking them in the end. I actually take 20 milligrams of citalopram every day. And I don't know if you know citalopram, but it's the antidepressant with half the calories. I can't believe it's not Prozac. The course is great, 6 weeks long, but for some reason I could only get to 4 weeks of the course. So I learned loads of jokes, but none of the punchlines. And I thought, I wanted a refund for the course, you know, so I went to see sort of Sam and I said, Sam, what have you done? 4 weeks after the course, can you have a refund? And he started laughing at me. But he's not laughing now. So, I come from a little place, a village, a little hamlet on the edge of Liverpool city centre called Kensington. It's all leafy green place. They actually call it Kenny. Everyone calls it Kenny. I don't like to call it Kenny, but you can't help it sometimes. For the first 5 years I lived there, I thought it was spelled E-E-E-E-Kenny. Because every time I said to people where they came from, they always went, E-Kenny. It's not as bad as it used to be. But the big problem with the moment in Kensington isn't crime anymore. Well, it's crime, actually. It is a crime, I'm going to tell you. But it's cultivating cannabis. Everywhere you go, there's a faint whiff of skunk in the air. And I found out there's three cannabis farms in my street. Now, they get really brazen about it, I don't even notice. You know, they fly over the helicopter, look for the heat signals. Well, these ones had signs outside. One of them said, "We deliver." The other one said, "All you can smoke." And the other one was, "Pick your own." Anyway, they got closed down now, so he's no use going back there. The other thing is, something else about Kensington, when I said it, but I can't remember. Anyone on the course remember what I'm saying next? Kensington. Okay, Kensington.
The bus stop.
What's that?
The bus stop.
No, I'm not doing the bus stop tonight. You missed that. Okay, so has anyone noticed that bees are big at the moment? They're on the news. I don't mean bees are big, you know what I mean? They're the same size as they normally are. Last time I saw them, they're the same size as they normally are. But they're in the news all the time because if we don't look after our bees, we're all going to die. There's no pollination, all the plants are going to die. And it's going to turn into a dystopian wasteland, a bit like the Boot Estate. And one of the ways of maintaining the bees is to actually adopt a bee. There's an adopt a bee scheme. Don't look after the bees. Right, so I went to the place in Kensington where they had the adopt a bee scheme. And you get this book with all pictures of bees in the ones you can adopt. So you look through the book, you look for like Gordon and Trevor and Arthur and Ken. Some female ones, well, but I didn't want to look at them. I didn't want people to think it was a bit funny. And you look at the bees like that. It gives you a little profile of each bee. It tells you what they like, usually honey, flowers. It tells you the type of music they like, sting. You get better later on. Rimsky-Korsakov. Does anyone understand that joke? No. Okay. So I picked a bee once, and his name was Albemarle, and. I paid me money, filled me form, I filled me adoption form. I said to the boat, "Where's the bee?" And he went, "It's over there." Anyway, Kensington's in a place, it's called a super output area. Does anyone know what a super output area is? No, I didn't think you would, I just made it up. Super output area, it's the posh way the government giving a posh name to poor areas that are a bit shite, like Kensington. There's lots of super output areas in Liverpool. And they all sort of make this arc along the edge of the city. So it's like a crescent moon. A bit like a croissant, actually. Right. So in a sort of ironic way, I decided this area instead of being called super amputators, could be called the croissant of inequality. Right. So anyone here living the croissant of inequality? Yeah, there you go, there's a Ken, there's a couple of Kenny people waving at me. I think they're waving at me anyway. And you know what the ironic thing is? You can't buy croissants in the croissants of inequality, which is a bit, I found a bit strange. We're going back to bees, actually. I had this fantasy about like starting my own hive, when, you know, starting a little swarm, Kensington swarm. And someone was telling me, it was in the home bay in Anfield. Has anyone been in the home bay?
Yeah.
So they have all this honey on show, and the honey is area-specific honey. So you buy the honey from one area, it tastes like the flowers and everything in that area. So I started thinking about what the honey would taste like in all the areas around Liverpool. So I thought, Alison tasted like caviar and champagne, right? And then I thought, well, what about Bolton? It'd be ciabatta, right, and olives. And then I thought about Toxteth as well, so that would probably be cutting goats and red stripe. And then I thought about Kenny, and of course it's going to have a little hint of skunk in it, hasn't it? And a bit of dollop of kebab as well. So while I was thinking about all this, this bloke came up to me in the pub, and he had his usual sort of thing, Kenny, if someone comes near you with a big plastic bag, they're going to try and sell you something. This bloke had a big plastic bag and he had a big coat on. He always had big coats on and a little weenie heads. If you notice, a little emaciated heads. And don't know why. Anyway, he comes to us next to me and said, mate, he said, I've got something in the bag you want to buy. I said, what is it? And he went, it's a beehive. Now, as soon as he said that, as soon as he did a bit surreptitious like that, you know, it's stolen. So I was thinking. But, you know, got the best of me because I was thinking, well, if I get a beehive, start my own flock or whatever you call swarm, and I start selling Kensington honey, all that type of stuff. And anyway, we're discussing it, you know, and he's telling me what's in the plastic bag. He said, I've got a beehive in there. He said, 2,000 worker bees in. Got a queen bee. He said, got a little smoke gun. With a little smoke gun to get the bees out, keep them calm. And one of them net things you put over your head. So I was thinking, it's like that about getting it. I thought, I'll do it. So I got the beehive and all the worker bees in the group at a telly. 500 net points. That's not the end of the joke. That's not the end of the joke. Okay. So I took it home, took it carefully home, put it on my kitchen table. Got a pair of scissors, cut the plastic bag open, peel the plastic bag back, open the beehive, and it was full of wasps. And then I realised I'd been stung. It just goes to show you, doesn't it, you shouldn't buy these things because it just perpetuates the theme in your area. That's all for me tonight anyway. You've been a great audience and you've laughed in all the right places. Thank you very much.
Safe to go back on his bed now. So, just a bit of admin, just so that everyone knows, it is a free course. That was a joke. We don't actually charge people to come on this course. I know the funders are here thinking, hang on, we've funded this project and you're making money from it. I mean, he did give us one of his kidneys, but he's from Kenny, so it was knackered anyway. So, it's fine. Ladies and gentlemen, we've got our next act coming on. Are you ready for your next act?
Yeah!
I was the other day, I was the husband, she had all that peculiar problems and the rest.
family, they don't scare. So we're going to do on for £1,000. Once you get to that, you pay a little bit of blood, a little bit of pain. You see, not bad, not great. No, so that's a little bit too much. But what's your lowest? What's your lowest? Come on for the tenner. So once you get to that, you oh, get loads of blood, loads of pain. The worst seat imaginable. I said, did you get the white people next day?
Skin for and just singing along with it. What else? tattoos. Now, they can be really good. I'm sure there's some really nice tattoos here tonight. But if they go wrong, for example, I'm sure you've all heard the joke about the fella that was standing next to the other fella in the toilet and he noticed had Wendy tattooed on his tudger. So he said, that's nice, is that your wife's name? I said, no, it actually says, welcome to Barbados, have a nice day. Now, you might guess that I'm not from Liverpool, but I've been here a long time and I love the place. So I thought, when I heard that joke, I thought, great idea, a bit of a tribute to where I live. So off I went to the tattooist and said, welcome to Liverpool, have a nice day, tattooed on my tudger. And he smirked a bit. I dropped the kegs and he had a look and he pissed himself laughing. Said, well, I can't promise much. I said, yeah, cheers, mate, that's a great start. But I'll put what I can. About half an hour later, in absolute agony, I come out of the tattooist, have a look at what he's put. Why? Bloody embarrassing. So, of course, the third one is this whole hashtag pig game thing. Now, that's not an embarrassment for me this time, but not ever, don't pick up on that, please. But, I mean, how embarrassing must it be for the family? You know, you learn that one of your relatives has had a politician's penis in his mouth at the dinner table. As for the politician, he was just getting in practice for what he's been doing to the NHS for the past 5 years. But of course the big one for me, and I think probably a lot of blokes, is when you hit adolescence. You start wanting to impress girls or, you know, basically explore sex. And, I mean, in my day, the way to do that was to go to discos. Now, I grew up in rural Lincolnshire in a little village called Normancombe Hardley, because I hardly come normally. It's a hotbed of incest. I mean, sex ed in that place was like, keep it in the family. I used to get this taken out of me as a kid because I found out I was an only child, and they used to crowd around me and go, virgin, virgin. So, anyway, for some reason, this girl took me under her wing. I've got to say, what with all those feathers? Okay. Decided to try and show me how to dance, because I listened to what girls like. You know, eavesdropped on conversations. It was all Saturday Night Fever and John Travolta. I spent 2 years walking into discos like this. Because I never saw the bloody film, I just saw the poster. So, this one night, she decided she's going to show me how to dance. Yeah, it didn't work. And we were getting on really well. I was playing over Becca Sider, and she was sort of showing me all her best moves. And I thought, yeah, I can actually, you know, get lucky tonight. So the music's blaring out. I decided to sort of suggest a few things, you know. And I'm like... So, a bit later, I had another go. Again, I'm starting to get stressed now, you know, and I'm sort of concentrating on this more than I am on the music. And I forget the music's about to end, halfway through what I was saying. So, I was like,
your knickers off!
Yeah, embarrassing. Anyway, she punched me in the mouth and then said, yeah, okay. And we had a torrid, short relationship. And I mean, what you've got to remember is the early 70s, it was the sort of tail end of free love and permissive society. Nobody was sort of too worried about things like HIV at that time. And, you know, we had this relationship, free love and that. Our last date was a nice walk up the aisle together in the STD clinic. And we were diagnosed and went our separate ways. I actually saw her a few weeks ago. My mother now lives in Skegness, and I saw this woman running a hot dog stand on the front of Skegness. I thought, yeah, she's the one that took my innocence and taught me how to dance. So, I went up and said, I'll have a hot dog. And we started chatting about how good life had been to us, and I thought, yeah, right, okay. And she said, do you want cheese on that hot dog? I said, no, I've been there, done that. Won the ointment, not again. So, the point is, as I say, you know, I can talk, obviously I can talk about a lot of things without getting embarrassed. But when it comes to mental health, I'm on, you know, which is strange, because one in four people, that's a statistic, will probably suffer a mental illness in their life. One in three in Liverpool, apparently. And, you know, when it comes to actually discussing it, as I say, get embarrassed. And the question is, to quote my tiny toucher tattoo, why? Thank you, you've been great.
Showbiz always end on a cheesy hot dog joke, ladies and gentlemen, and that is the golden rule of showbiz. We've got one more coming on in this section. Mark's just been, like, everyone's had their own journey, and I hate to use that word journey because X Factor have ruined that for us, haven't they? But everyone's had their own little thing they've had to sort out. Mark, a couple of weeks ago, Mark was so nervous. A couple of weeks ago, he did loads of work on his stuff, and it just went, and I think he's come so far. Can we have another round of applause for Mark? Keep that going, bro.
My name's Peter Stanton. I've got a dilemma at the moment because as Jimmy will approach the stage to help me out, I forgot my reading glasses. So Jimmy's going to help me out. Even when I go to William Mills to put me best on, I invariably forget my reading glasses. The first one I'm going to say is this fella goes to doctors, you know, and he approached the doctor and he says to the doctor, "Doctor, I've got a very mysterious complaint." He says, "I need the best of reassurance, assistance and help from you." So the doctor says, "Well, that's all above board," he says. "Come in the surgery," explains the symptoms. So he says, okay, he goes to the surgery. So the doctor says, "What seems to be the problem with you?" So the bloke says to the doctor, "Well, it's like this, doctor. For some obscure reason, it's quite mysterious to me. I've developed a steering wheel upon me nudger, you know." So with that, the doctor says, "In all my history studying medicine, medical health of the world, and psychology of the mind," he said, "I've never been approached with symptoms of such a variety, has it?" He says, "It's beyond my diagnosis and the extremity of my career." He said, "I'll have to leave it to your own viewpoint." He said, "It's been beyond the comprehension, you know." He said, "What's your own personal viewpoint upon the matter?" So the fella says to the doctor, he says, "Well, to be perfectly sincere and honest with you, doctor," he said, "it's driving me nuts." Elaborating on that, two chimpanzees, they're having a bat together, you know, being friendly chimpanzees, obviously, you know. So one chimpanzee is making strange chimpanzee noises while they're enjoying their bath, you know, bathing in the bath. So obviously, ordinarily, as a chimpanzee would do, he's doing these noises, whatever, you know, as a chimpanzee. So the other chimpanzee, he turns around to him and he says, "I told you to put some more bloody cold water in." Anyway, this aeroplane, and he approaches the pilots, the co-pilots, the stewards and stewardesses upon the plane, and he says to them, "I'm in the process of hijacking this aeroplane." So with that, the pilot, the co-pilots and the stewards are panic-stricken upon the aircraft with the scenario of the Tomcat on the plane. So next minute, the Tomcat remonstrates to the people on board the plane, "Take me to the Canaries." Don't ask us that. Regarding animals in general, you know, there's this fella. This is a bit long-winded, by the way. to say the least. This is one of my dad's favourite jokes, which is quite sentimental to me and my mum and my family, you know. Anyway, there's this fella in the midst of the Amazon jungle, and you've got to imagine this scenario, you know. He's dressed in a tartan suit, he has a David Crocker's hat on, a Winchester rifle, and a pair of Jesus sandals. And what his profession is, he traps lucrative fares such as leopard skins, cougar skins, panther skins, lion skins, cheetah skins, raccoons and beavers, you know, of all dimensions. And when he does get these lucrative fares, he gets very elaborate dividends from a mate of his who trades them in for him. Well, what it is, he's always found a bear very elusive to capture, you know. And it's avoided him in capturing a bear. So one of his professional ambitions to capture his ambition of a bear, you know. So anyway, he's in the depth of the forest one day in the jungle. And a mate of his approaches him. And he said, "Apparently, I was speaking to a friend of yours the other week, and he said, he told me the knowledge to the effect that you've always found a bear elusive to catch." And he said, "Well, that's quite correct, you know." So he said, "I'll let you into an inkling of a little secret, you know." He said, "What you've got to do is," he said, "you've got to hide yourself under the undergrowth of all the forest and the jungle." He said, "You've got to make yourself very inconspicuous, and you've got to approach your bear's lair or den, and you've got to look for the trail of the footsteps of the bear. And when you notice the bear's footsteps where the lair is hiding, the bear is hiding in its lair, you know." He said, "You've got to do this to entice the bear, from the den, you know." He said, "You've got to approach him very inspicuous, and you've got to go like this. He said, "And then the bear will be enticed from the lair, you know." So anyway, he goes, "Oh, well, thanks for the information," he said. "It's always been my ambition to capture a bear," whatever, you know. Anyway, a few months goes by, and the man who's given them the advice comes upon a friend of his, and he says, "Apparently your mate, who's found elusive the bear, you know, he's in a terrible state in the hospital, you know. He's in traction from head to foot in plaster Paris." And he said, "He was speaking to you a few months ago in relation to catching a bear, which he wants to find a lucrative, elaborate lifestyle and trade the bear skin in, you know." Anyway, it's a bit long-winded, you know. So he says to him, he says, "I've done exactly what you said. I made myself very inspicuous." He said, "I have the Winchester rifle ready to shoot the bear between the eyes when he enticed the bear from its lair. He said, I went like this. He said, I got mowed down by a bleeding train.
Polar bear goes down to the Liverpool and he's seeing the Iceland. wall to wall freezes. And he goes in the ice. Oh, this is great. Jumps into the freezer. Oh, this is heaven. He saw an ice cream. Takes the top off. The manager saw him. Jumped out, down the aisle, down the street, got away from the manager. Gets to the garage, just gets to the garage. The mechanic's there. It looks like you've blown a seal. No, it's ice cream. Four people are going to have a mental health issue. I'm serious. I was in a pub the other night with three of my mates, and we just couldn't decide which one was the best. Now, men, as we've said before, men do not take to being told you're ill. No, I'm not going to the doctors, I'm mad. You just don't do it, do they? Especially with mental health issues. And my wife, God bless her, she really does look after me well. And she knows that when I'm not behaving quite properly, that she starts to fuss over me. In the door, threw me coat off on the floor, kicked me shoes off. You all right, love? Nothing wrong with me. You don't look very well. Told you, there's nothing wrong with me. Don't you think you should get your eyes tested? There's nothing wrong with my eyes. Could I suggest you pick that stuff up, go next door to your wife and ask her. Magician and the parrot on board ship. Parrot's at the bar, magician's doing his tricks. Every time he does a trick, the parrot goes, "It's up his sleeve, it's up his sleeve." There's another trick. It's in his top pocket, it's in his top pocket. The ship hits an iceberg, goes down. On the life raft, with the parrot and the magician. 3 days of silence. Parrot couldn't handle it any longer. Okay, where'd he hit the ship? Sex. The only thing I managed to do these days. I've got this favourite channel, what's it called? Oh, help me! The National Geographical. I was watching the mating ritual of the house sparrow. And there he was, trying to find a partner to start off his life. Tried all day, you precious sat in. Sat on the bench. Thank you.
pants off. I promise I was young, I was experimenting with shit. But I must make a confession, by the way, I really didn't want to take partners at that time. And it wasn't so much that I was scared of standing up for the really good people. The more I thought, how do you know I'm actually standing up? And this is it, 5 foot 5 inches of what used to be regular muscle. Unfortunately, Father Time's caught up with me and I forgot what I was going to say. Father Time's caught up with me and, you know, I used to be scared of their grip getting over. Now that I'm in my 60s, it's not so bad. You get to do things like hide your own Easter eggs. There's some short up under the stairs, but never mind. But I can't play Easter eggs in this poetry CD for you. It's my wife's coming. It's crap so good with the shit every night. Have you seen the price of the chardon these days? You're paying £7 for fish and chips. Back in my day, you got Moby Dick for £7. I can't contradict, but I did get Moby Dick once, but I went to the chemist, got some and said I was cleared up. My memory's not as good as it used to be. I always be able to remember things like, what am I supposed to say next? Yeah, but I come from a large family. I wasn't going to say that. What I was going to say was, maybe I shouldn't be nervous because I've actually tread the boards before that comes across. Thanks very much for that. I'm really happy. Because I have actually tread the board before. You know, back in the 70s, I was one half of a musical duo, and we were quite successful on the local circuit. We were called the Symbolics. But when Sim left, I just got to play on.
Giggling, I'm pointing at my Jane the Tiger. I'm just getting a bit high ground. that you haven't saved every property. And she gave him, she's going, oh, you weary. And I thought, no, I'm not having this. You know. I said, look, Elaine, I said, you're a grown woman now. I said, it's not a weary, it's a prick. And she said, no, a prick's 3 times bigger than that. Two beautiful daughters, and the other one's in the audience tonight, and she gave me a lift home, so I've got to say all this. Unlike my mother, who had 8 children, my mother had 4 girls, 3 lads, and me. And so, like a lot of women of their age, there's no such thing as sex. So what you're looking at tonight is actually a molecular conception. We did some camp positions, we lived in the settlements in Kirkdale. We lived in camp conditions. I had to share the bed when we were kids with two of my brothers. One of my immediate younger brother, our Michael. And this is generally true. He was £3 when he was born. That's all he weighed when he was born. He came to visit us the other month. I had to knock 2 walls down to get him in the house. I think I don't know what happened to the fucking next. And the other brother was my eldest brother, our John. Whose party piece when we were kids, when he would walk up in the middle of the night, he took great trouble to walk all over my face. And that hits the face. But if you flash forward, she must have not been shy, by the way. If you flash forward another years, I still was still sharing the bed with me elder brother. We were young men by this time. And his party piece now was, whenever he had a few drinks, he'd wake up in the middle of the night, open the wardrobe, and he wasn't missing the wardrobe. But always on my side. I'm the only person I know with a piss stripe suit. On the way here, I was really thinking, the only person in my family really I haven't mentioned that is my dad. And it was my great friend Peter who told the joke about his dad told him. Reminds me of a joke that my dad told me. My dad didn't tell jokes because he had the worst stammer in the world. And the joke is this, it's a very old joke. Ventriloquist, cracking ventriloquist, but he can't get work. There's no call for the ventriloquist. And he's talking to his mate, he's saying to his mate, I'm not earning any money here. He said, well, never thought of branching out and doing something else. He said, what do you mean? He said, well, hasn't he become like a clairvoyant or a medium? He said, I never thought of it. He said, think about that. And he's sure enough, he owns up in some shop as a medium. And now he works in this day. He said, yeah, well, what can I do for you? He said, your husband, he died 12 months ago. He said, we're married 50 odd years. I really missed him. I want to get in contact with him. Can you do anything for me? He said, yeah, I'm sure. He said, well, how much do you charge? He said, well, there's the prices up there. £10, £20, and £40. She said, well, what do I get for £10? Oh, he said, £10, he said, you get to talk to your husband, he doesn't talk back to you. Oh, she said, well, that's no good. He said, well, what do I get for £20? He said, well, for £20, you get to talk to your husband, he doesn't talk back to you. Oh, she said, that's right, you know. He said, well, what do I get for £40? Oh, he said, well, for £40, he said, you get to talk to your husband, and he doesn't talk back to you. Well, I'll drink a glass of water. The day my mum pulled me to one side, and I'll never forget the words she said to me. She said, who are you? All of my disorders were 27 years of age. I'd like to tell you, say the words to you exactly what I said to my mother. My name is Kim Scully, it's been a pleasure in the world. I'd like to leave it, if I can, in the words of a man who I consider one of the greatest comedians of his generation, the late and great Dave Allen. Good night, good luck, may God bless you.
Ladies and gentlemen, are you well?
Yeah.
pounds phone down the toilet.
Yeah.
After soaking in a bag of rice for 2 hours to get the moisture out of it. Yeah. Works fine now, but I've lost only contact apart from one. My Uncle Ben. My Uncle Ben. Do you want one? It's for nothing. How the pilots keep this? They do aerobics down the gym there. No, we can have a laugh together with the stress. I'm so stressed. All the time I'm stressed. Stressing out all day about what to wear tonight. Not always with this cool, you know. Well, I am cool, but everyone always with this cool. I'm the youngest of nine. When I got up to go to school, there was never anything left for me to wear. One morning I get up, and all that was left was Anna Nan's clothes. That's a go to school as Anna Nan. Did all her lessons for her. Wasn't too bad. I learnt how to sew, and I was a knit. They could all knit in the old days, couldn't they? My man Pearl sat in the corner, knit one, pearl one, knit one, pearl one. All she did, knit one, pearl one, knit one, pearl one. Here's a jumper, lad. Woolly jumper, goes to school, you woolly jumper. All the other kids in the brand new gear. Oh, look at him in his woolly jumper. Next day I'm going in, woolly tie. Well, thanks, man. Next day, woolly blazer. 100% of your woolly, she said. I said, that's what they call me at school, man. Next day, pair of woolly shoes. She couldn't have it. Never stopped knit one pair of one. Curtains, knitted. Wallpaper, knitted. Top to floor, knitted wallpaper. She missed me a kettle once. Out of my wall. Carpets, knitting, three-piece suite, knitting. Three-piece suite, knitting, all the people. Colour telly, knitting. It was a bit fuzzy, the picture, but at least everyone was in colour. Used to come round to watch Match of the Day, in colour. The house, knitting, everything. It was all great until they had the flood. 4 days later, I guess they'll be all dry out. Everything shrunk up the walls. All me little brothers and sisters shrunk up. They were real. I was a wee kid. That's why I was nothing like them. I just heard today, the world's oldest sheep, Donnie, died aged 25. Yeah, terrible that. The farmer said he could only keep it wrapped up in cotton wool for so long. Yeah, and Benny says to me, for my birthday, Dad, he said, can you go to the animal rescue centre? Oh, you've been watching Blue Peter. Animal rescue, he said, can you get me a deaf sheepdog? Well, a deaf sheepdog, I said, I think we'll find it. That's a come by, lad. That's a come by. So, we get some a cat. That's two cats we nearly own now. Because the white one, Merlin, just disappears, days on end. Never did. Off it goes, just disappears. Hangs around the old lady at the end of the street. You can tell when women are up, they buy a wheelie trolley thing with them. And they buy cat food from Sainsbury's and steal other people's cats. But the black cat we got in, the kitten, that's crazy. Just run around the living room. The bully wallpaper, down they were fixing it. Up and down, silver paper, everywhere, all over the living room, there's silver paper. Silver up the stairs, silver paper. It's on the living room, drugs, that cat. Definitely on drugs. And Berlin, who disappears for days and then, goes off to Amsterdam on the easy jet, doesn't he? That's what's happening. It's going down to John Lennon Airport like that. All right, mate. Just come on to Amsterdam. Yeah, all right, all right. I'm just going for a few bulbs for the garden, you know, I'll be back soon. So he's over there in Amsterdam buying the gear. Then he goes to the other cats. Anyone fancy coming down to the old, the windmills, the old windmills in Amsterdam? There's a little house there. Where? There, on the stair. The one with the wooden clogs on, love clippers. Not a good idea for a mouse wearing wooden clogs and bad cat around. Straight in at it. Then he comes back through the customs at Liverpool Airport. All right, mate.
Hey, Merlin, that's what you've got in your bag.
Nothing, man, just a few bumps on the gun. Okay, straight through. He's walking around and he's got a little bell on his neck, mate. But he changed it. He's got a chain. It's a Snoop Dogg, not Snoop Cat. He's got a great big gold chain round his neck. He's got a diamond encrusted food bowl. Gold cat flap to stop the other cats getting in. Security cameras on it. It's not a half dog in the world. Because that was when all my gear was going missing. My iPad went missing. My bike will be next off the shed. The little black cat. All right, mate. Do you want to buy a bike for a tenner? A
I've only got a fiver on me. Oh, come on, it's got a basket on. You can put your kittens in it. No, mate, it's only got a half a cotton. Here's Merlin, come on, a snoop cat. Oh, my dear cat. Anyone want to buy me top grade? Meow, meow. So, yeah, I'm terribly sorry. The drug dealing cat. A woolly warpy. Relax, because I'm so stressed. So I'm looking through the internet and I'm seeing their advertised. Flotation tank. I'm like, oh, I've heard of them. Angelina Jolie and all them stars in Hollywood, they use them, don't they? So I found one in Romney Street and I phoned up and I said, can you sell me another flotation tank, please? I said, I think you'll find it's a sensory deprivation chamber. A sensory deprivation chamber. I always turn to me and say, sensory deprivation chamber. Can you tell me where I'm at? And she said, it's absolutely an amazing experience. You'll be in complete darkness. You won't be able to see anything. You won't be able to feel anything. And you won't be able to hear anything. I said, it's almost like a candle special, but I want to find out that one. She went, very funny. Very funny, oh my God. So I went down. And she says, right, first time here. I said, yeah. I said, well, she said, go straight to the top of the stairs. We can't go any further. You'll find a sensory deprivation chamber, totally immersive experience, very neat, anyone in Liverpool, absolutely amazing. So I'm like, okay, I'll have some of this. So runs up the stairs, walks. There are 50 million stairs. Well, still be millions, I don't know what I'm doing. No, we got to the top, about 5 floors up. The room's pitch black. Wow, they've gone to town on this sensory deprivation experience. Goes in, I've just seen the corner there, the tank. So goes in, gets me kiss off, puts me woolly trunks on. Well, pulled out and takes the lid off, sets the timer, gets in. God, it was cold, that water. And straight through me. That's a warm the water scrub a bit. Well, it was just the once. Well, twice. Well, three times. And so small, I was cramped up like that. Couldn't get used to it. You know, couldn't get used to it. I thought, it's good for you, it's good for you. Must take a few goals. Anyway, cuts a long story short. I'm going there for about 6 weeks and I finally managed to get into me. I'm lying there. I'm counting sheep. And I drift off. And I can see I'm in the Sahara Desert. And there's all pitch black. Stars are beautiful. There's a blood red moon coming over. Oh, it's amazing. I'm in there going, oh, this is it. Next thing, I'm dreaming. I'm back in school. I'm in school and I've got a three-star jumper on. It's brand new. I've got Birmingham bags on. I've got a Ben Sherman shirt. I've got platform shoes on. Oh, that's amazing. Excellent. All these cats coming in. They're moaning at my feet. They're eating my shoes. My clothes are off me. There's a bright light in my face. There's a woman shouting, get out! Get out! I go, go away! Go away! I'm in a sensory deprivation chamber. Go away! And she goes, you're not in a sensory deprivation chamber at all. You've been lying in the septic tank for the last 6 weeks. That's why they all went back up downstairs. The water tastes for me and they're still on a turn. And I said to her, well, after that scare you give me, love, sensory deprivation chamber, if you pop your head in there, I think you'll find it is a flotation tank.
Oh, it's fantastic and it's coming from all the way over there, ladies and gentlemen. Start your clapping, start your tuning, please drop it on your hands. Hello,
you know the fellow that was on first, John with his suit? It's a great party, I've been there, it's fantastic. Yeah, number one and number two were there as well. Amazing. My name is... do you know what? I'm really not very good with remembering things, so this is my little script sheet. And my set isn't very long because I'm running out of battery. My name. I'm not very good at remembering names. Okay, which is not very good in my line of work because I write the film directory. I don't really, I'm a teacher. Helen was talking about this course being about breaking down taboos, and I hope on stage
I don't break down to booze. So I did that. See, I think that's quite great. Thank you. That's worked out. Right. Now, my name is actually Ali. And, and that actually fits in, because you might say, Ali, that's a girl's name, isn't it? Yeah? Yeah, well, you tell that to Muhammad Ali in his prime, yeah? Yeah, but you might say, Ali, that's a Muslim name. Actually, yes it is, and maybe you could tell that to Cassius Clay before he became Muhammad Ali. Well, actually, probably, sorry, I did. Anyway, moving on. My name, Ali, is actually short for Alistair. Yeah, Alistair. It's a Scottish name, and it's not that funny. But it's a Scottish name. You can see that I'm wearing my mum's tartan, because, thank you for the time. And it's actually, so it's on my mum's side, and my mum certainly sighed when I came out. No, she didn't really, she's lovely, and I look at it. I've got down here, job. What job do I do? I'm a teacher, so I'm used to standing in front of people laughing at me, so this makes a pleasant change. Yeah, and you must. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, I'll only do it on that high. I've still got a little bit of battery left. So, what do I teach? I teach English. Because I think it's really important to be the goodest that you can be. And grammar and very important. I also teach maths as well, so we do adding, taking away, timesing and dividing, or divvying. And I'm a divvy about 60% or 3/5 of my time, so there's a little bit more maths for you there. But most of my lessons actually are not English or maths. They are actually red, yellow, and blue. Yes, I'm primary. My, how you've groaned, I predicted that. And that's what I say to the kids after the summer holiday. Right. It's a great job, I love it. I've got to go back to marking after I've done this. Anyway, why am I here, you might be asking yourselves. I've got why here, question mark, in capitals. You might be asking that, and so might I. Well, I've got some marriage issues, actually. This is actually true. Oh dear, I'm going to go off script a little bit. Because I won't get back on it again. I've been to a counsellor, and yes, to relate. I don't know if any of you know what relate is. It's a... Can you hear me, by the way? Am I doing okay with the mic?
Yeah.
Thank you very much. It's nice to get a bit of a yes. I haven't had a lot of yes for quite some time. Relate is a place for couples with problems. Some of which can be functional problems. But with me and my wife, we've got no problems in that department. Because you can't have problems in that department if you've been sleeping on the couch for the last 3 months. True. We have been going to counselling for quite some time. I used the royal we, because it was... She only came the first time. Which is the story of my marriage. At the first meeting... do you know how much it costs? Do you know how much it costs for counselling? £55 an hour. So it's quite good to come on this course because it's a lot freer and more laughs and there's a better view because it was in Thomas and John's town. Fantastic. Anyway, I'll get back to my script-ish. Better view, yes. Oh, stone Buddhas. I've got two stone Buddhas in my garden. Okay? One on the left, one on the right. Okay, and I don't know how we got talking about this, but my counsellor said, okay, well, tell me a bit about your stone Buddhas. And I said, well, they're in my garden, my yard. I like to call it, it's a bit like a garden, a bit like a yard, So I call it a yardarm, because I'm a twat. Anyway, the Buddha on the left, I deliberately put it there because it's kind of a skinny Buddha, it's got its eyes closed, and it's praying. Okay? And then I've got another Buddha, and it's in the shade as well. On the right, I've got a kind of a sort of a fat Buddha. Not, I'm not you, sir. Okay? You're very spelled. So, fat Buddha, who is laughing, something that I need to get used to, laughing and in the sunshine. And she says, well, that's interesting. Really interesting. Which Buddha do you think you are? And I said, I don't think... Well, I didn't say that. She said, then she interrupted me, and she said... she did, yeah, because I forgot where I was. And she said, I think you are the skinny Buddha over here, okay, in the shade, and you want to be the fat Buddha over here, again, not you, in the sunshine laughing. Okay? And I said, and she said, which one do you think you are? I said, I don't think I'm either Buddha. I think I'm the sad man in the middle of the two inanimate objects having a breakdown, thank you very much. What a mother Buddha she was. So, anyway, after that session where I went on my own to relate, I went back to my house, to my wife, and you'll never guess what she said to me. Nothing, she left. And on that note, I am going to finish. Now, my name is still Ali, it says on here. Thank you for being there, okay? And thank you to all the comics here, because they've been amazing. I've had a great night. Thank you very much. Enjoy the ride home. Let's all go to the party!
Party. I was kind of joking, but it seems we've sort of, you know, caught fire, so let's go. Not caught fire, that's a horrific party. Let's go and put the fire out. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. That is the end of the show. But, just a couple of things. This is the Feeling Funny course. It's run by the Comedy Trust. The Comedy Trust run programmes throughout the year, and also the Liverpool Comedy Festival that's on at the moment, of which this show is a part of. So grab a brochure on the way out. Festival shows all across the city. The Comedy Trust, if you want any more information about that, speak to myself or Helen. Can we get a round of applause for all the staff here, ladies and gentlemen, for all the staff? The pepper and the sound on the door. Can we get a round of applause for Brady? Can we get a round of applause for Anne, who helped me in session? A round of applause for Helen. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, finally, it's only fitting that we end this show by thanking and giving a big congratulations to every single person who's stepped on a stage tonight. And it's, we say at the start of the course, stand-up comedy is easy and anyone can do it. And actually, that's a massive lie. Because it's quite difficult and it's a very scary thing to do. And obviously everyone's got on today and everyone's done a great job and the show's been fantastic. And it's not been that kind of, like sort of, you know, sympathy laughs, genuine belly laughs, which is fantastic. That's what this is all about. So, to close the show, we have a massive round of applause for every single one of the 10 performers.